Thank you both for being here today. A special thanks to the jury members who, for some of you, come from made a long trip to come here. It's a great honor for me to be able to present this work that started 4 years ago now. And as you can read on the slide, I'm going to talk about connecting AI approaches with cognitive interventions. To start this presentation, I'd like to take a very simple example that may seem straightforward, but it will help to illustrate the key concepts that are crucial to understand my talk today. So imagine you're walking down the street alone, and you're deep in thought. You're like, am I ready for this PhD defense? And while you're trying to focus on this, there are unrelated thoughts that pop into your mind for no apparent reason. You're like, how do planes fly? Or what's the purpose of them? At the same time, as you walk, you're processing a huge amount of visual information, objects, and various details around you. And as usual, you are coordinating your body, moving smoothly around obstacles, controlling your legs and arms without much conscious effort. Though it seems completely natural, this process actually involves a wide range of abilities. One of the most important ones being the ability to filter through the vast number of internal and external stimuli. In practice, this ability to focus on relevant stimuli in any given situation is called attention, which is a crucial cognitive function that plays an essential role in our daily life, everyday lives. In practice, this ability will manifest in different situations, so that are known as modes of attention. So for example, when you're doing multitasking, you're in a divided mode of attention. When you hear your name called at a Starbucks in a crowded, noisy place, you're using selective attention. When you focus on a task blocking out all distractors, you use sustained attention. By the way, I hope you will use this mode a lot during the presentation. And finally, when you stay alert to any emergencies, you're in a state of vigilance. So with this in mind, it's crucial to first understand how attention deficits impact daily functioning. These challenges are already evident in neurodiverse populations, such as individuals with attention deficits or hyperactivity disorders, or those experiencing cognitive decline, often associated with aging, for example. However, in our increasingly digitalized world, the demands on our attentional systems are growing. This is a phenomenon known as the attention economy. And this raises an important question. Can our attentional system can be restored or trained to better meet these new demands? In fact, this question is not a new question. So for instance, during the early 19th century, there was an American teacher named Catherine Eichen who wrote a book where she described how instead of teaching the usual mathematics, biology, history, she was trying to develop the method to train her students' mind. For instance, she was writing a sequence of digits on a blackboard like this, and then she was switching the blackboard and asked the students to actually remember the sequence. Our philosophy can be summarized with the ideas that students might possess certain cognitive abilities that could be trained, and that these abilities could be then reused in other contexts, such as learning about history, geography, or biology. What Catherine Eichen described at that moment is in fact very close to what cognitive scientists now called cognitive training. That is to say, practicing very specific sets of activities that would target certain abilities of the brain that can be further reused in other contexts. Since Eichen's time, many cognitive tasks were developed and studied, and many training were developed as well. And they are usually classified into two kinds, either multi-domain ones that rely on several tasks to train on, or single domains ones, the kind that we are going to focus on today. And so in this work, especially, we'll be interested in a task that focuses and that targets visual attention that is called the multi-object tracking task. So the multi-object tracking task, MOT for short, is a very simple task that targets visual attention, in which participants are presented with targets in red here. And after a few seconds of presentation of these targets, the targets are going to turn into the shape and the color of the distractors in yellow here, and the participant is tasked to track the target presented. So we're going to give it a try. Not sure it's going to work, but let's try. So be ready, the red dots are going to turn into yellow and move in the scene, and you have to track them. So I don't know if you managed to track the targets, but let's say you answered those two objects. Actually, it's a failure because you selected wrongly a distractor and missed a target. So as I said, it's a very simple task that requires visual attention to keep track of the targets and inhibit the distractors. So this task is interesting because several theoretical works explaining the mechanism for tracking, as well as correlational studies establishing the link between the MOT with other cognitive components, so showed that this task is connected with visual attention, visuospatial perception, or other cognitive components such as working memory. Additionally, the task has been shown to correlate with real-world metrics. So for the MOT task, reaction times are most of the time not really used. So there, the performance at the task is correlated with real-world metrics such as sport performance or video game proficiency. And as such, from this observation, arises one of the main motivations behind nearly all cognitive training programs, that is whether the correlation might in fact be turned into a causal relationship. In other words, can you say that by training on the MOT task, we will see an improvement in other contexts on other untrained tasks? To assess this idea, most cognitive training programs are evaluated through the use of cognitive batteries that are proposed before and after the training. Cognitive batteries are sets of specific tasks that will allow to evaluate the degree of transfer from the trained task. So they are often chosen to be from a near transfer to a far one. But I think it's already important to keep in mind that this notion of transfer is in fact a multidimensional concept. And that, so as it was described in a previous paper by Barnett and Ceci, and that this difficulty of properly defining the notion of transfer is in fact a great example of the multiple issues that comes from the cognitive training literature. And in practice, as it has been well showcased this morning, notably by Claudia, this kind of difficulty led to mixed results in the cognitive training literature. So if we focus on trainings based on the MOT task, for instance, there are today evidence in favor of transfer after MOT training. So, for instance, previous work have observed improvements at biological motion perception for older adults, or increase in sports performance, so it was pacing, passing accuracy in soccer tasks, or on other cognitive tasks, such as working memory tasks. And on the opposite, there were also studies showing no effect of the training, or at least no far transfer of the training toward other cognitive tasks. So these mixed results are there are several open questions that still need to be solved behind these mixed results. But today, I'd like to make a focus on this problem, which is the high inter-individual variability in response to such program. That is to say, if some participants improved after trainings, others do not. To To tackle this issue, previous work have already showcased that adaptive procedures would lead to greater improvements than non-adapted ones. So to understand what we've done in this work, I propose to have a look on the current most used procedures for adaptation. And we will see in a minute that our claim is that the current adaptive procedures might possess certain limitations that we could solve. So first, to understand this adaptive procedure, there is an important concept that comes from developmental psychology that was introduced by Vygotsky that is called the zone of proximal development. So the ZPD for short is the idea that the best opportunities for learning are situated in a zone where actually you can do the task with a little bit of help, most of the time by help from a social partner or a peer. And it relates to the notion of intermediate difficulty where you learn on tasks that are not too difficult, not too easy. So with that in mind, the goal of most adaptive procedures is to push participants toward this zone of proximal development. To do so, most adaptive procedures define the concept of activity space that corresponds to the space of all possible training activities that can be proposed to a participant. And it can be, for example, a continuous space like this, where each dimension will represent one parameter that configures one aspect of the task. So for instance, if we take the MOT task, we can consider three parameters to control the difficulty, such as the number of targets, the speeds, or the distance between objects. Seems easy, just skip two parameters. And with the idea of ZPD, the goal of the adaptive procedure will be to push the participant toward this ZPD that can be represented here in the middle. That is represented here in the middle. So to push the participant toward the zone of proximal development, most adaptive procedures in the cognitive training literature rely on an algorithm called the staircase procedure that prior to the training, define a route or a path through the activity space. The idea of this path is to manually create an increasing difficulty that will lead the participants to eventually encounter activities in his zone of proximal development. So to move along this path, then, the participant will be proposed with an increasing difficulty if he succeeds twice in a row, for example, or with a decreasing difficulty if he fails once. So this is a very simple procedure, but it's also one of the most common ones in the cognitive training literature. So as I already said, we claim that there are some limitations with this kind of procedures that we further developed in a systematic review that is now submitted. And among the different limitations, there is this idea that even though participants can go at different speeds on this prior path, actually this prior path will prevent from going on other trajectories in the activity space. And so depending on the activity space, this prior path will maybe make the participant miss a better fitted trajectory. And as such, this observation leads us to the question whether we could do maybe better than this kind of procedures. And to answer this question, I propose to tackle the problem by first discussing a little bit how humans learn and how, for instance, they explore their own environments to build a repertoire of skills. So let's put a baby in a room and we'll put some objects in this room. And we'll look at the trajectory of the baby, how he explores the space. Actually, we won't see any random trajectory. The trajectory of the baby will be somewhat organized, while there is no instruction that is given to the baby, that is to say, there is no direct external reward that is provided to the baby. So this means that there are internal drivers that push the baby towards certain objects more than others. So many theories were developed by different psychologists to try to explain these exploratory behaviors. So for instance, drive for surprise or to maximize tasks with high uncertainty. There are plenty of theories. But today, I propose to focus on a specific idea, which is the learning progress hypothesis that states that actually babies and more generally humans exploring their own environment by themselves are attracted toward activities on which they progress. So to develop this last hypothesis, I propose to demonstrate it by introducing some experimental results from a previous study. It is in fact a game in which participants are tasked to find what food corresponds to each of the four monsters. The family of monsters has first to be chosen, so here the participant has chosen the red family. Then the participant has to choose the correct food that corresponds to this family. And finally, he gets a feedback if he was corrected or not. In practice, depending on the family that is chosen, the available learning progress and reward is experimentally manipulated. So for instance, here with the red family, the food is always the same. So the task is really easy. There is no progress available. For the green family, the food is always different. So in fact, the activity is unfeasible. And as well, there is no learning progress available. For the yellow family, it's quite different because the participant can infer the rules behind how to feed this kind of family, and so there is available learning progress. What's the most interesting with this study is the idea that so participants were exploring the game without any rewards. They were asked just to play on the game. And what was quite interesting was that the best fitting model that was explaining the free choice exploration was composed of two components, the first one being the learning progress. So participants were attracted toward the family with available learning progress. And when there were two activities with the same learning progress, participants chose the one with the hardest difficulty. So in practice, this idea is encapsulated in the learning progress hypothesis, which propose that the experience of learning progress obviously leads to learning and memory retention, but that learning by itself is intrinsically rewarding. So in other words, there is some kind of feedback loop that reinforces the state of intrinsic motivation when you're experiencing learning progress. And in fact, this idea is closely related to the zone of proximal development model, because activities with high learning progress will in fact be not too complicated, not too easy. So our initial motivation was to try to answer this question. And so by leveraging this learning progress hypothesis in the lab, in the Flowers lab, we've been developing several tools, educational tools. So for example, 10 years ago now was developed an intelligent tutoring system. That is to say, a system that provides to a learner an optimal pedagogical sequence of activities. And this project aims to teach children some mathematical skills. And while developing this project, new algorithms were implemented, such as the zone of proximal development and empirical success algorithm. This would be ZPDUS for short, that propose to lever the learning progress hypothesis we just introduced. As a side note, today, ZPDUS is used as a much larger scale. It has been further reused by a company, and so it's now available in every primary schools in France. Okay, let's summarize the main ideas and concepts that we have. So we've seen that there are existing cognitive trainings that aims to train or restore cognitive abilities. We've seen that there are existing adaptive procedures that might possess certain limitations. And we have seen that we developed other ways of doing these adaptive procedures that we could reuse in this context. So that's the main idea of this project, which is to compare an adaptive procedure based on the staircase algorithm versus a procedure based on the ZPDUS algorithm to manage the difficulty of MOT training. There will be three main research questions during this talk. First, we will ask whether the training trajectories proposed by the two procedures are different. Second, we will look at the improvement after training, and we will compare the two procedures on suspect. And finally, we will look at the subjective experience of the participants through the week. Okay, so now now that we get the main ideas, and after this quite long introduction, I'll explain a bit what was the experimental design and methodology we used. So first, the first things that we had to do was to choose what were the parameters on which the adaptive procedure will work on. So we choose five parameters that are presented here. And to do so, we conducted first a large reviews of the parameters impacting the MOT performance. So there is today a narrative review about it that is submitted. And another motivation to choose these five parameters was that the project was initiated after discussion with the Daphne Bavelier's lab in Geneva. And over there, they just finished an experimental campaign using this MOT task, and they encountered issues with the staircase procedure with high dimensional space like this one. So as I said, we'll compare two strategies to adapt the difficulty, the staircase one that from now on we'll call the control procedure, and we'll compare it with the ZPDS algorithm. So let's now dive a little bit into the mechanism behind the ZPDS algo. So first, there is a mechanism that limits the exploration of the activity space by the adaptive procedure. That is to say that instead of exploring the full space, we will just restrict to a subset of activities that can be proposed to the participant. So we'll start only with, for example, here, just one activity that is available to the participants. And then we will make this subset evolve through time with very simple rules. So for example, if the mean success rate in the available set of activities is higher than a certain threshold, we can welcome new activity in the zone. Then, if one activity has a success rate that is higher than another threshold, that is to say, if the activity is mastered, we can delete this activity from the zone. So we have a first mechanism to limit the exploration of the space. Then, within this zone, we need a mechanism to actually choose activities. So if we follow the learning progress hypothesis, the algorithm should be biased toward activity with high learning progress. So to do so, we keep track of the empirical error of each activity, and then we can estimate the learning progress of each activity by just taking the derivative of this empirical error. Then, a multi-armed bandit algorithm is used to randomly sample an activity in the zone, and the activities are in fact weighted by their learning progress. That is to say, activities with high learning progress will have more chance to be drawn and sampled and proposed to the participant. So to sum up, ZPDS will propose an activity and get a response. It will estimate the learning progress of this activity. It will update the available zone of activities. And in this zone, it will sample an activity and propose it to the participant. So the experimental design is very classical for cognitive training. So we have our two conditions. In addition, the intervention lasts 10 hours with a call that clearly states that the participants are going to train their brain. There is a pseudo randomization into the control or ZPDX group at the beginning to ensure that there is an homogeneity in terms of age, gender, attentional capacities. And every day there are two sessions of 30 minutes that the participant can manage as he wants in his calendar. There are also 2 days of break in the middle of the intervention. Every 4 days, there is an evaluation to assess the performance on the MOT task. This evaluation is made on the MOT training, and participants are unaware of this evaluation. But this provides us a way to have reference points on which we can compare directly the performance of the two groups. So the task is very similar to what I described at the beginning. The only difference is that we used gamified visuals. So this one was developed in the Daphne Pavelier's lab, but then we developed our own visuals through the use of generative AI. We also had some gamified components to guide the participants through the intervention. So for example, the small character Dr. Flowers guides the participants and explain what are the main features of the platform. Then there are also feedbacks on the time progress. So we created some kind of mini stories to make the participants understand where he was on the intervention. And finally, we also provided some kind of feedbacks of the participants' progress that we can discuss a little bit more after. So okay, that's only it for the experimental design. What's left is how we assess the cognitive performance evolution. So we had a cognitive battery that was proposed before and after the training. This battery was developed at the very beginning of the PhD project and relied on 8 cognitive tasks that were shown to correlate with the MOT in the literature. So there is also a paper about this if you want to read more about this cognitive battery. Additionally, we also had assessments of the subjective experience of the participants. So we had some questionnaires to get a sense of the profile of the participants included in our studies. And we also had repeated measures to get a sense of the evolution of motivation, cognitive load, engagement, or learning powers. So this is the complete experimental design. Also, to keep the questionnaire phase as short as possible, all the questionnaires were not proposed every day. So there were at most 4 questionnaires every day. Okay, so now we can turn to the main results of this work. So during the 4 years, there were plenty of different experiments. I'm not going to show you all the results we got. I will focus on the 2 last studies with the larger sample sizes that conducted to 2 different papers or that are in preparation. I hope we'll be able to submit them very soon. As you remember, the 3 main research questions are these ones. And we will start by looking at the training trajectories. And we will focus on the younger sample, but the patterns are quite similar for the older adults. So it's complicated to display trajectories in 5-dimensional space. I guess Julien already told us a bit about that this morning. So I propose to represent the activity space as it's done here. So the dimension number of targets will be unfold. So we will look at each number of targets independently like this. And then the 4 remaining dimensions represent the 4 other parameters. For each level of each parameter, we will display a dot that represents when this level has been proposed for the first time. So the color of the dot represents when the activity has been proposed for the first time. So for instance, this red dot here that represents a high value of speed has been proposed for the first time after 450 episodes. Then the size of the dot represents the proportion of the time that this level has been proposed. So it's the frequency of the value over the entire trajectory. So values that are more proposed, we have bigger dots. So let's look at the actual trajectories. By the way, this is only for single participants. This is not at a population level. So here, for a control participant, we can observe that these participants did not spend a lot of time on 2 and 3 targets levels, and that the 6 and 7 targets level were unreachable. Additionally, we could see that the participants was quite locked for a long time on the 4 targets level before accessing the 5 targets one. For the ZPDS participant, the pattern is quite different. All targets level were open, even the 6 and 7 ones. we can also see that the dots are less concentrated around certain areas of the space. And so for instance, in the two targets level, we can see that there are big dots for high values, which corresponds to probably learning progress, even for two targets level. So there are interesting subspaces, even at the two targets level. So I showed you the graph with all the activities that were proposed to the participants. But in fact, maybe the 6 and 7 target level that were proposed to the ZP2S group were all failures. So they were not interesting, but the ZP2S spent time on this. Actually, when we filter the activities with only the succeed ones, you can see that there are still success in this high difficulty levels. To finish with this graph, I just reorganized them, and here I displayed the number of transition from a certain number of targets toward another number of targets. So the thickness of the line represents, is proportional to the numbers of times the transition was lost. So what I'd like you to remember from this graph is the idea that ZP2S participants might have encountered way more variability in the trajectory, as it can be seen here for more transition between the target level. And also, as you can see, there are jumps, for example, from the 2 target level to the 7 target level, which are very different activities. Okay, then you might think that I just chose cherry-picked trajectories. So just to show you at a population level, we can have a sense of a similar pattern. So here, I displayed for each time step, so for each episode, the proportion of the population on each target level. And as we could see with the participant trajectory, population level, we can also see that there were participants proposed with the 6 and 7 targets, for example, and that there were also more variability in the ZPDS trajectories. Okay, to finish with the training trajectories at the population level, I wanted also to show you very quickly the success rate through time that was way lower for the ZPDS group. But what we need to keep in mind for this graph is that here, the success rate does not take into account what were the activity that were that the activities that were proposed to the participants. So if the success rate is lower here, it also means that the activities proposed were more difficult. Just to keep that in mind. Okay, so then the question is, how does this learning trajectory what these learning trajectories induce in terms of cognitive enhancement? So I displayed 11 metrics that comes from the cognitive batteries that we used before and after the training. And I'll start with the Young sample. So we used a Bayesian framework. I'm not going to develop the whole methodology behind this analysis, but we can discuss further after. So just here to understand, we used the Bayesian framework to get the posterior distribution of each metric at pre and post test for each group. And then from this posterior distribution, we could compute the difference of the post between the post and the pre, and even the interaction, that is to say, the difference between groups of evolutions. And here the plus sign represents an evolution, a probable evolution from pre to post test for each group. So on the slide, there is no interaction effect. This is just a within group evolution. So what we could see from this slide is that, as expected, there was an improvement on the MOT task, which was a bit reassuring because participants trained on this for 8 hours. So it's good to see that, at least. There were improvements of both groups on 3 other tasks. And what's maybe really interesting with this slide here is that for the Young sample, there were improvements only for the ZP2S group for 2 tasks. And what's interesting is when we look at the pattern for the older adult sample. Because as expected, we also see that there was an improvement on the MOT task. We also observed an improvement for 4 tasks for both groups, but here we observed an improvement only for the control group. So if I sum up these results, what we could see that was that actually there might have been different patterns with a broader improvement for the young sample in the for the ZPDUS group in the young sample and a broader improvement for the control group in the older adult sample. Okay, this is where the last line of analysis might provide some insight into what happens. So looking at the question of how many target participants were able to track with difficulty, we could see that basically none of the participants in all groups were able to detect their own learning progress. That is to say, we were able to see objectively that there was an increase of performance for all the participants, but when we asked to report this learning progress, they were unable to actually detect it. Then, when looking at the NASA TLX questionnaire, so questionnaire to measure the cognitive load, we were the results were quite clear. So there was a main effect of the group with the ZPDUS group in both samples showing higher effort, higher mental demand, a lower sense of performance, which was then in line with a lower intrinsic motivation for the ZPDUS group and a lower engagement, especially for the young sample. So I think it's time to discuss a bit these results, because they are not clearly what we expected at the beginning. If I summarize them very quickly, we saw that there were very different learning trajectories between the ZPDUS and the control. So notably, there was higher variability in the ZPDUS trajectory and also a lower success rate. These different learning trajectories led to possibly different improvements or different patterns of improvements depending on the sample, with broader ones in the ZPDUS group for the young sample or broader ones for the control group in the older adult sample. And finally, in terms of questionnaire, we observed that there were no reported feeling of learning progress, and the ZPDUS group showed lower intrinsic motivation, and higher effort, and higher mental demand, a lower sense of performance, and a lower engagement. So in practice, these results might be seen as limitation of the work, because they go a bit in the opposite direction as what we claim at the very beginning. However, I think they provide like very insightful observation that can lead to fruitful discussions. So for instance, if we start from the observation of the higher effort, mental demand, lower intrinsic motivation, in fact, this may seem opposite to the initial claim that the ZPDUS participants, by providing high learning progress activities, will be more motivated than the control procedure. But in practice, we observed that the participants were not able to report any feeling of learning progress. So in a sense, this goes in line with the learning progress hypothesis, because in the learning progress hypothesis, it's the experience of learning progress that leads to a state of intrinsic motivation. So if objectively participants in practice progress, subjectively they were not able to detect it. Then it's also important to try to understand the reasons behind this, the fact that participants were not able to self-report their learning progress. So first, maybe there is this hypothesis that the MOT task is intrinsically challenging to evaluate the progress on. This can be translated by, in fact, participants for this task, it was quite complicated to detect when they were provided with two different tasks. So it's easy, for example, when you provide three and six number of targets, but when you make the difficulty evolve through the use of the speed dimension, it's way more complicated. So participants are able to get a sense that it's a bit more complicated because the speed is a bit higher, but they are not able to explicitly say, okay, the speed is equal to that value and that the participant actually improved on that value. Additionally, a second hypothesis is that the feedbacks We provided to help the participants estimate its own learning progress, were unutilized, or were not as good as we hope. So they were not used to support the learning progress estimation. And on top of that, so we've seen that there was this high variability, notably in the ZPDS trajectories, which makes maybe the learning progress estimate also more complicated, because the learning progress estimation that you're doing on this task is in light of the previous task that you encountered. And so if the participant is proposed with a very with a high variability in the training trajectory, it requires the participants to actually remember what were the previous tasks and to make the difference between its actual performance and the previous one. So this have maybe make the estimate also more complicated. Additionally, it's possible that the high variability and the low success rate due to the ZPDS exploration have made the trajectories more effortful for the participants. And that it's also possible that these trajectory features are part of the reasons behind the difference of evolution in cognitive performance evolution. So it's possible that the large variability that were observed was profitable, for example, for the young samples, because while it was more like an obstacle for the older adult sample. So that's also something I think we'll discuss. And I think the results are also quite interesting because they reveal that we should maybe consider other dimensions in the learning progress hypothesis. So for instance, we could ask or discuss the impact of metacognition. This is to say the ability to know what we know, or the impact of cognitive load, that is to say the amount of cognitive resources that you have to put in the task to complete it. By the way, these observations are in line with many other works in the literature that is discussed in the thesis. So with that, even though more experimental work is needed to really understand what is happening, we could rediscuss the learning progress hypothesis by maybe splitting the learning progress into two components, an objective one and a subjective one. The cognitive load and the metacognitive abilities would then be moderators of the experience of this learning progress. By adding these components to the model, then we could think of several ways to improve our to improve the ZPDS algorithm. So for instance, better consider the cognitive load levels, we could find or could think of better mastery identification procedures. So for instance, there was a recent paper that used the change points detection algorithm to better detect the mastery with the ZPDS algorithm. Or we could also think of ways to actually in the multi-armed bandit procedures, to add a secondary objective to push the algorithm to choose activities with high learning progress, but also with an optimal success rate or an optimal, let's say, cognitive load. We could also think of considering the metacognitive aspects. So, for instance, we could ask the participants whether he thinks he's progressing on the task and try to consider this in the algorithm. Or we could also even try to think these metacognitive skills as a new objective for the algorithm, that is to say, to try to train these metacognitive abilities in addition to training the performance on the cognitive tasks. So in addition to these new features, there are future experiments that are planned already. So for example, there will be a cognitive training based on the MOT task on the population of small vessels disease that will be using the MOT and our ZPDS procedure. Or on another project, the cognitive battery that we developed will be used to assess the impact of screens on children development. So to finish with this talk, so first I hope it was not too demanding. I know it was maybe. And I would conclude that there are still many steps to do, and most of the experimental work remains at a very, very early stage. But I hope that we contributed a bit to pushing new ideas and methodologies into the communities. So with that, I thank you for your attention, and I'm ready to answer questions.